If you would open in your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 1, if you don't have a Bible with you, you're welcome to take one from the back table there and make it your own and follow along as we study this magnificent book beginning this morning. Well, between 65 and 70 A.D., a doctor named Luke sat down with a parchment, I imagine. I imagine him trembling, perhaps closing his eyes in prayer, joyful and sobered by the task in front of him. He had something that God wanted him to say. It was a story, but it was more than a story. It was a sequel. It was a sequel to the most world-shaping event of history. The story he was about to tell was connected to that event. It was the result of it. The way a harvest results from sowing seeds into the earth. The way the world is enlightened by the sunrise. The light had indeed risen. And now he would describe how the light was flooding the dark corners of the earth. He began his letter by reminding his readers of just how central, how transforming that event had been. These are his words. These are God's words, written in Greek, translated for us into English. Let's read verse 1, the book of Acts. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach, until the day when he was taken up, after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit, to the apostles whom he had chosen. To them he presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, these opening five verses are the beginning of a prelude. John writes the first chapter, and in many ways, the first chapter, certainly through the first 14 verses, are a prelude to this story he wants to tell. It is a magnificent story. If you know the book of Acts, you know that to be true. It is a life-altering story, and that's the intention. This story is history, but it's not merely history. It's biblical narrative, and biblical narrative always intends to transform us. It's not merely transmitting knowledge of the past. It's claiming us. It's calling us. It's inviting us. And by the preaching of it, God's word in narrative or any form transforms us. And that's what I wanted to say to all of us this morning. I had a phrase that kept coming to my mind as I thought about launching into this lengthy series in the book of Acts. We're going to take our time. We're not going to go quickly. We're going to walk through it slowly. And here's the encouragement I wanted to give all of us. Prepare to be transformed by Jesus Christ and his advancing gospel. Prepare to be transformed by Jesus Christ and his advancing gospel. The first five verses of this book highlight the themes that we're going to encounter as we walk through this book. They highlight those themes that Luke and God behind Luke intend to transform us, to shape us. And so even in looking in these first five verses, as Luke looks back in many ways to the conclusion of his first work, the Gospel of Luke, he's wanting to look backward, but also even in doing that, prepare his readers for what's to come. He's pointing them backwards. He's saying, remember, I want you to remember something, but it's a memory that's intended to shape us. It's intending to affect us, to transform us, to remind us that something history-altering, world-altering, life-shaping has taken place. If you imagine a person standing up on a stage at a theater and saying, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? And instantly, every eye looks up. And in that moment, when everyone's watching, the speaker announces either something that has just taken place or something that is about to take place. And that's exactly what Luke does here. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? Remember what has just taken place. And now let me tell you what is about to take place. And Luke would say, what is still taking place. Three themes that focus on the Lord Jesus Christ and anticipate the rest of the book, but three themes that Luke dives right into as he opens his masterpiece, his second half of his masterpiece, the book of Acts. Three themes. First of all, his glory, then his messengers, and his spirit. Luke begins by reminding this person, Theophilus. We don't know exactly who Theophilus was, but we think it was just a person that Luke was dedicating this book to. He might have been a wealthy patron, perhaps just a young Christian, someone who was young in the faith. And Luke is writing to him, and Theophilus, in some ways, is like us. He is in need of this story. He is in need of transformation. And so we can see ourselves in some ways in that name. It might be as though Luke is saying, in the first book, Christian reader, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up. So Luke reminds this reader, and he reminds us, that there was this period of time after Jesus rose from the dead when he was instructing and revealing himself to his disciples, and he was giving them commands and orders and kind of anticipating what was about to happen. And so he looks back at that 40 days period of time between when Jesus rose from the dead and he ascended into heaven. And this passage, though it's narrative, it's just describing in a few verses those days, it's packed with clues about the glory of Jesus Christ. It's packed with it. And I think Luke starts this story talking about Jesus because he wants to establish that as a primary theme as he then describes the creation, the birth of the church of Jesus Christ, the explosion of the gospel around the world. It's packed with themes, a couple of themes that reveal God's glory. First of all, these 40 days focus on his authority, they focus on his resurrection, and they focus finally on his exaltation. His authority, his resurrection, and his exaltation. Notice there in verse 2, it says, during this time, he gave commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles that he had chosen. So notice the authoritative emphasis on the person of Jesus Christ. He's able to give commands. Those commands are communicated through the very Spirit of God. So this is a man that speaks with divine authority, divine aid in his communication. And he has the ability to choose emissaries that represent him. This is a man with incredible authority, with stature. He is ordering them, in verse 4, not to depart. And he's predicting that the very Holy Spirit of God will attend the arrival of this new day that he's initiated. So before anything else happens in the book of Acts, we have Luke reminding us of the incredible authority of Jesus Christ. He's able to speak with divine authority. He gives commands. He has emissaries that represent him. There is this kingly aura about him. The authority of Jesus just displays his glory right from the beginning. And he's reminding Theophilus, he's reminding us, remember the authority of Jesus Christ. He is Lord, Luke would say. Not only his authority, but also his resurrection. You notice in verse 3, Luke wants to make absolutely sure that his readers know that Jesus presented himself alive after his suffering by many proofs over many days. Luke has great concern that his readers would not think of Jesus as merely an effective prophet or an excellent messenger, a teacher, an example of somebody who loves others, who cared about the sick. He wants them to know, look, something happened and it was absolutely verified. It was brought into the eyewitness category. Jesus rose from the dead. This man not only has authority in life on earth, he has a kind of a validation, a confirmation as the one who has defeated death. And this is eyewitness proof, Luke seems to say. These men that we're about to talk about, that went, many of them, to their death following this Lord Jesus and proclaiming his message, they witnessed him dead and they witnessed him alive. So that if you are questioning the value of his message, let me give you overwhelming confirmation. He rose from the dead, Luke says. And it was validated. It wasn't just his hearsay. It was confirmed that he rose from the dead. And this passage also reminds us that this particular resurrection wasn't just like others, and they had heard of others that had risen from the dead. Jesus had raised a young girl from the dead. He had raised Lazarus from the dead. They were dead and then they were alive. But he reminds them through this little word, suffering. You notice that he rose from the dead after his suffering. He presented himself alive after his suffering. And Luke reminds them, look, remember what I wrote in the first book. This opening paragraph, it seems to assume that we are aware of the story of the first book, the book of Luke. And in that suffering, he reminds them, look, Jesus didn't just die an ordinary death. He suffered on a cross. And for a Jew, that was worse than saying he died in the electric chair, because it included the idea that God himself was cursing him on that cross. So that the suffering of this man that presented himself alive was not merely human suffering. It was a suffering in facing the wrath of God for sinners, which is what Jesus declared to his apostles in that final meal, which Luke records. And he says, this is the new covenant in my blood. My blood is establishing a new covenant with you. And the only way he could do that is if he was a substitute for sinners, so that little word suffering, it reveals Jesus Christ died in the place of sinners and for their sin. And he went to the grave bearing the sins of his people. So it's important to understand the message that's being communicated, the glory that's being communicated when this one presents himself alive. This isn't just a resurrection. This is a victory. This is a vindication. This isn't just Lazarus, where he was dead and now he's alive. This is the curse-bearing, sin-bearing representative of humanity going into the grave and suffering by going to his death, bearing the sins of his people. Now, those sins deserve to be in the grave forever. They deserve to be punished forever. They deserve to be crushed forever. And Jesus truly bore our sins, because if he hadn't, he never would have gone to the cross. There's no reason for the Son of God to suffer unless he's suffering in the place of someone who should suffer. So the only reason Jesus suffered was because he was taking our place. He was bearing our record. So when it says that he presented himself alive, Luke is declaring the punishment for our sins was fully satisfied in him. And when he rose from the dead, our record rose in him. That's the good news Luke is saying. Right from the beginning, the first three verses, he's saying, look at the glory of Jesus Christ. Look at his glory. Look at him. Look at his authority. Look at his resurrection, and that it vindicated the sufficiency of his suffering. So that sin-bearing death was enough. And God rose him from the dead. Remember, think of it this way. When God raised Jesus from the dead, he was saying that the sinful judgment, the judgment for sins of John Payne, was fully satisfied. When Jesus rose from the dead, he was saying, look, the judgment that was placed on Jesus instead of Catherine and Alan and Aaron and Bart and Mike, it was satisfied. And now he's alive from the grave because those judgments and those sins have been fully completed in him. So he presented himself alive to them, giving them confirmation that his mission to save sinners was vindicated by God the Father himself. What's Luke doing in these opening verses? He's saying, look and be transformed at what has happened. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. Finally, his exaltation. Notice that phrase in verse 2, when he was taken up. He spoke these things until he was taken up. Not a reference, I think, to his resurrection. This is talking about after his resurrection. And then you notice later it says that they have to wait for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Now, in that category, we're going to read a lot more about this in the next couple of weeks. There's this very important theological statement. Jesus didn't just rise from the dead. He was then exalted to the right hand of God himself. Jesus rose, and then he was ascended up into heaven and placed on God's throne to direct God's purposes for his people in history. That's what's in that passage, and I think that's what's implied when Luke begins. It's almost like a massive literary wink at the beginning of this passage, if you notice it. Look at here in verse 1. He says, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do. All that he began to do. And he's talking about the passage, the time period after he rose from the dead. And he's saying he began something right then. He began something. But then he was taken up. And then the apostles had to wait until he was taken up for the Holy Spirit to be poured out. Now, theologically, what this is saying is that Jesus Christ was exalted to be the chosen ruler, the chosen representative of God for God's purposes for salvation and judgment on the earth. You remember when we read in Daniel and it talked about the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven? And as he comes, he is given dominion and a kingdom. Well, this passage about Jesus being taken up and that they have to wait until that time for the Holy Spirit to be poured out, it's just saying in story form, here's what's happening theologically. Here's what's happening. There is a kind of divine order. First, the Messiah King is crushed as an atonement for sinners, and then he is raised in vindication of the sufficiency of his death, and then he is exalted to God's right hand, and then the fullness of the new covenant that he purchases is poured out on God's people, and that new kingdom era begins. Luke is packing these themes into these first five verses. It's like the ultimate teaser. The ultimate teaser. He's saying, look, be transformed at the glory of Jesus Christ, at Jesus Christ, and anticipate his advancing gospel. Because something has happened that is world-shaping, that is world-changing, that is life-transforming. His glory. His glory. We need to be shaped, transformed by the glory of the risen and the exalted Christ and his purposes on the earth. We need to be shaped by it. We need to be aligned by it. We need to be directed by it. We need to set our course by it. We need to set our calendars by it, by the glory of the risen and exalted Christ and his purposes in advancing his gospel on the earth. I read a story this week about a woman who wanted to be blind. According to the story, she could see, but at a young age, she decided she felt more comfortable being blind. She began to practice being blind. Now, I don't know, because it was the internet, whether this is a valid story or not. It could be a total false story that she's lying and this never happened. They have interviews with her, but who knows if she's telling the truth or not. Maybe it was an accident that made her blind. I don't know. But as the story went, she progressively chose to render herself more and more incapable of sight, to the point of literally blinding herself. According to the story, again, don't quote me on it. But whether it's true or not, I thought of a true story that is even more tragic. And the true story is for a Christian to act as though they have not seen the glory of Jesus Christ. To function like a woman like that, who walked around with dark shades over her eyes and attempted to act as though she had not seen, when all the while she could see. That's Luke's burden. That's Luke's concern. He writes to this guy, Theophilus, it might have been me, and he says, look and see, open your eyes to see the glory of Jesus Christ. Consider that he rose from the dead, and not just any death, but an atoning death, so that the atonement was sufficient for you, for your sins. And consider that he didn't just rise, he was exalted to the right hand of God. And consider that he is now the head over God's purposes for humanity. Don't live your Christian life shaded and blinded to that reality. Let your life be transformed by Jesus Christ, and anticipate his advancing gospel. His glory. Longest point, but two other points I want to make. His messengers and his spirit. You notice that the audience of Jesus' commands is the apostles. Luke introduces them immediately as well. The apostles. He gave these commands after he rose from his apostles. We know there were 12, but Judas betrayed him. And so there was 11 after he rose from the dead. And he presents himself to them as eyewitnesses, as he gives commands to them. And he commands them to wait in Jerusalem for the coming of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Now, this indicates, it sort of hints at something that is going to be throughout the book of Acts, an astonishing development in God's purposes. It's this: God is entrusting the message of the glory of Jesus Christ to human messengers. God is entrusting the message of the glory of Jesus Christ to human messengers. In the wisdom of God, and frankly perplexing, God is entrusting the glory of his Son and the message of it being proclaimed and all that we just studied to human messengers. And obviously these men had a unique role. They had a foundational role. They had an eyewitness role to establish the beginning of the message and to confirm it by their eyewitness testimony. They had an authority in the early church. But as we read in the book of Acts, their transmissional role was then handed on to others. A quote I've heard in the past that I will repeat over the course of this series, because I think it's an important way of hearing about it, is something that an old preacher said. I don't know exactly the reference. There's, I think, some dispute about it, but the old preacher saw another preacher approaching, or he was talking about another preacher that he said was much more effective, much more articulate than he was. And as the story goes, he said, well, he might preach the gospel better than I do, but he can't preach a better gospel than I do.
He might preach the gospel better, but he can't preach a better gospel. And I think that's a very helpful analogy for how we're to think about these apostles. Now, yes, they had a unique role. Nobody should stand up and say, I'm the reincarnation of Peter today. However, they do not preach a better gospel. Quite the contrary, they've handed down the gospel to us. And so what we read in Acts and in this very opening chapter is that Jesus had a plan, had a purpose for his message of his glory and his resurrection and what it meant that he was the Lord of all and the Savior offering salvation to humanity, that it's entrusted to human mouthpieces. These men primarily, and then following in their footsteps those that come after them. It's entrusted to you. It's entrusted to me. Paul says, we have this treasure in jars of clay, so that it might be shown that the surpassing power does not belong to us. Brothers and sisters, this is a major second theme and reason why we wanted to preach through this book of Acts. We want to feel the privilege and the burden and the responsibility and the task of carrying this glorious message about the person and work of Jesus Christ to those around us. We do not want to keep this message to ourselves. We cannot keep this message to ourselves. We must not declare that the glory that we have seen be kept for ourselves, but shared with those around us and those around the world. There is too much glory to merely keep it for ourselves. And so this passage, right from the beginning, he makes it clear. Here's how the news is going to be spread. You guys. And if you've read the earlier work of Luke or any of the other gospels, you're aware this is not because they were so naturally impressive. And if you're intimidated about evangelism and sharing the gospel, there's good news. Because there's a third theme that Jesus introduces in this first five verses that is true throughout the book as well. His glory, his messengers, and his spirit. His spirit, you notice that he says to them in verse 4, and Luke emphasizes this, he's going to repeat it again in the passage next week, that John baptized you with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, this phrase, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit, is loaded with theological meaning. You could take a whole series of messages to talk about what that means, that you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. At minimum, it means that in the way that John symbolically was seeking to declare a recommitment to the Lord through a water baptism that washed the outside of people and as a symbolic representation that they wanted to see their hearts cleansed, now God himself is going to wash the inside of his people and cleanse their hearts and endow them with a access to his presence and his cleansing power that they had never experienced before. In addition to that personal meaning, it also means that God is initiating a type of interaction with his people that is accelerated, is beyond, is extreme in comparison to anything he had done in the Old Testament. He is going to make himself the inhabitor of his own people. This means that Jesus Christ and the era that has begun is the era in which God dwells within his people. It's the era of a new covenant, a covenant of access and approachableness to God, a covenant of where God himself is moving in and through them. And if we think about the rest of the New Testament, we see the pervasive day that Jesus has ushered in. Because we remember that it is the Spirit that causes us to cry, Abba, Father, assuring us of our salvation. It is the Spirit that empowers witness, in particular through the book of Acts. It's the the Spirit that bears the fruit of godliness that the Old Testament people had so longed for and had so often fallen short of. It's the Spirit that is the deposit of our inheritance, which is to see and experience the unveiled presence of God in heaven. So this phrase, you will be baptized with the Spirit, it's saying the new day has come. The day of Christ. The day of Christ sending his Spirit. The day of encountering God in the midst and within his people. The day of the Spirit's transforming work. The day when the Spirit himself leads and guides as Christ's agent to enthrone Christ on the lips of his people and to empower them to proclaim his message to the darkness of the world. So if hearing that combination of his glory entrusted to human messengers is daunting for you, and it is for me, take heart in the third theme that's brought into this passage. You will be transformed by Jesus Christ and his advancing gospel because Jesus Christ has opened the door where the Father can send the Spirit into his people. You being transformed is not merely a matter of willpower or obedience or thinking enough about Jesus. It includes all of those things. But more fundamentally, it's something that the gospel itself does because this gospel brings with it the gift of God himself within you. So that it is not more anymore just you that is called to proclaim this message. It is God himself speaking through his human representatives on earth, his people. Prepare to be transformed by Jesus Christ and his advancing gospel. His glory must be remembered. It has changed history forever. His message has been entrusted, and his Spirit has been poured out on people, men, women, boys, and girls who otherwise would be weak and insufficient and not impressive in themselves, but through the coming of the Spirit with the message of Jesus, they have the most powerful force on earth. As Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. I was playing with one of my sons last night, and I came home, and our living room was destroyed because they had built a fort, and there was no place to sit because there was blankets and pillows and infrastructure and everything set up in this room, and they wanted to show me all the cool places and everything, and so they had this one place, and I think they called it the safe room. A little concerning where they got that phrase from, but it's a safe room, and I went into them much as I could into this room, and it was pretty dark. They had done a pretty effective job. It was fairly dark, and at first, my son was very proud of this, and he was wanting to tell me how cool it was that it was so dark. And we got in there, and he's saying, look, isn't it great how dark it is? It's great, and you can't even really see. Can you really see my face, Daddy? You can't really see it. It's so dark. So that went on for a few seconds. And then the darkness started to affect him. What he was initially impressed by, he began to be a little squirmy. And to paraphrase him, it was something like, it's kind of spooky in here, isn't it? Yeah. And I could tell something was beginning to happen. This wasn't so cool anymore. I really can't actually see your face very well in here. It's a little spooky, isn't it? Yeah, it is. It's a little spooky. He said, okay, let's go out now. So I started to go, and you know, it's a small tunnel. I couldn't just like burst out of the thing. So I'm backing up as best as I can. And then he's getting, okay, Daddy, let's come on.
Brothers and sisters, this world is filled with people that have never seen, really seen, Jesus Christ. And it's fun at first. It's kind of dangerous and exciting. But somewhere deep down, it's a little spooky. And the older you get, and the longer you live, the spookier it gets. You start wondering whether you'll ever get out. You start pretending it's not that big a deal. You start staring into the darkness, pretending you can see light. What would we do if one of those people came to us and said, "It's a little spooky in here. Can we get out?" Jesus sends us into this world. There's more light in this room than most people experience their whole life. Jesus is sending us into this community, into this world, as into that dark room with people who say, "It's a little spooky in here." And he's entrusted to us this message. Let me tell you what happened. Jesus Christ rose from a death that should have been my death. But he rose, which means I don't have to face that judgment. And if you believe in him, you don't have to face it either. And we do that not in our own strength or because we've fixed ourselves or cleansed ourselves or made ourselves good enough, but because God himself has given us himself and the person of his Spirit to make it true what Jesus said, that "I am with you always in every dark room and to the end of the age." Brothers and sisters, let me invite us as a church, and I include myself and pastors and the small group leaders and everybody else, let us place ourselves under the transforming effect of this book. Let's let the light of the glory of Jesus Christ shine on us week after week. Let's receive the fearful and surprising but privileged calling of being messengers. And let's welcome the truth that God has given his Spirit to make them what they cannot make themselves. And let's be transformed. Let's remember what has happened in Jesus Christ, like Luke says in this first passage. Remember, essentially, the passage basically says, remember, Theophilus, let me tell you, receive it. Receive again. Let me write down for you what has happened in Jesus Christ. What he did after he rose and what he said would happen after he was exalted. Let me remind you of these things so that you can be transformed by them. Let's listen to this good doctor and behind him to the Lord as he speaks to us week after week. And let's be transformed by Jesus Christ and his advancing gospel. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for including us as recipients of this glorious news. Lord, thank you that you rose from your suffering. And thank you for all that that means. Lord, the sufficiency of your death, that our sins are paid in full. They cannot condemn us anymore. Lord, thank you that you rose, Lord, with full authority over your church and over God's purposes in history, and that you're exalted to the right hand of God. Lord, we come to you and declare that you are our Lord, and we see you by faith seated there and declare our allegiance to you and our loyalty to you and our trust in you. We pray that you would transform us. Lord, I pray on behalf of our church, Lord, that you would give us humble and willing and moldable hearts, ready to be inspired, ready to be sent, ready to be overwhelmed by your glory. Use us, Lord. And we pray, Lord, for this surrounding community. We pray, Lord Jesus, for those right now in these homes, in this immediate neighborhood, in the neighborhoods around, in the cities around, Lord Jesus, that you would illuminate their darkness by the glory of the message of your gospel. Lord, we pray you would shine your light into their hearts. We pray, Lord, that you would give us opportunities, that we would have conversations and we would build relationships, that we would have moments of speaking and then seasons of speaking, that we would give us a chance, Lord, to invite them into this place where we declare your gospel and that we would bring your gospel to them. Lord, we pray for these moments and we pray for the courage to take them. Lord, as we have studied and read these last months, you are sovereign. Your kingdom will endure forever. And so we trust you, Lord. We reject fear and worry and anxiety that's attending these kinds of calls in your word because we trust the sovereign one who rules over all. Give us faith, Lord. Give us courage. Give us boldness to drink in the light of your glory and to turn ready to share it with each other and with those that are around us. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.